بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله العليم الخبير المتقن نظام العالم بلا معين ونصير، فسبحان الله الذي حكمته بالغة وعلمه غزير ونعمه واصلة إلى كل صغير وكبير. ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له في نقير ولا قطمير، ونشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدًا عبده ورسوله الذي هدانا بكتاب منير ودعانا إلى الله بالإنذار والتبشير، صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه ما دامت الكواكب تسير. أما بعد، فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في القرآن المجيد والفرقان الحميد: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: ولو شئنا لبعثنا في كل قرية نذيرا. صدق الله العظيم. Honorable scholars, respected brothers, friends and elders, mothers and sisters, Ibn Asakir rahimahullah makes mention of a narration on the strength of Zayd bin Aslam that once Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab radiyallahu anhu left his home at night to patrol and to take watch and guard of the affairs of the Muslims. خرج عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه ليلة يحرس. So as he was patrolling in the streets of Medina, فرأى مصباحا في بيت. He observed that a lantern was burning in a particular house, which was an indication that the occupants were still awake in the late hours of the night. فدنا منها. So he came close. Those days the homes were nothing lavish. فإذا عجوز تطرق شعرا لها وهي تقول أبياتا. As he came up close, he found there was an elderly aged woman. She was carding her wool, she was spinning her wool, and as she was spinning her wool, she was singing along praises of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, before I share these couplets, a quick reflection. The noble companions, when they would engage in any activity, mundane or spiritual, coupled with that, their tongues would be moist in praising Allah Ta'ala and sending salutations on the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So when the Sahaba would dig in the trenches, which was an arduous task, it was a challenging task. نَحْنُ الَّذِينَ بَايَعُوا مُحَمَّدًا عَلَى الْإِسْلَامِ مَا بَقِينَا أَبَدًا. One narration is Islam. While they dig in, it was challenging. We often find our domestic, while washing the dishes, in her vernacular language, she might be singing something along. نَحْنُ الَّذِينَ بَايَعُوا مُحَمَّدًا. We are those that have pledged our allegiance to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Thick or thin, you know what, rainy weather or sunshine, we will stand, honor and oblige by this commitment. And he sallallahu alayhi wasallam would follow it up by saying, Allahumma la aisha illa aisha al-akhirah. Oh Allah, the only good and the only life is the life of akhirah. Faghfir al-ansar wal-muhajira. Forgive my ansar and forgive my muhajireen. When the sahaba were carrying the load of building the bricks of Masjid al-Nabawi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, so we find three different couplets. Uthman bin Maz'un radiyallahu anhu was a very meticulous sahabi. Was a very well, neatly attired. And he was the first muhajir who passed away in Medina. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's daughter Zainab bint Muhammad passed away, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after attending to the rituals of the burial, he then kissed Uthman bin Maz'un on his forelock and he said, Ilhaqi bi salafina Uthman ibn Maz'un. May you be joined with the likes of Uthman bin Maz'un. So by nature, he was a very clean and a well-attired person. So he would take a brick, place it in the construction of the masjid, then he would dust himself. He would dust himself, then he would take another brick, put it on, and if there was a speck of dirt, he would dust it off. So Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu, and look at poetry was in their nature. In a very humorous way, he said to him, today is the day to be enveloped in dust. Today is the day for your clothing to be soiled. So he said, لا يستوي من يعمر المساجد يدأب فيها قائما وقاعدا ومن يرى عن الغبار حائدا. Those two can never be equal. One who works and tires relentlessly and passionately in the construction of the Kaaba, and the other one who keeps himself aloof so that no dust can settle on his clothes. And Uthman bin Maz'un radiallahu anhu realized that that was a hint to him, and then obviously he got his hands soiled in. And then they said, "La in qa'adna wa nabiyyu ya'mal ladhaka min al-'amal al-mudallal hadhihi al-himal la himal khaybar hadha abarr li rabbina wa athhar." If we were to sit while the Nabi of Allah toils, that would be the most deplorable action. And if I can say to the youth of today, if you were to sit while your dad has to answer the doorbell, then that's the most despicable. And if I can say to the daughters of today, if you were to sit while your mom is preparing the food and you hail and healthy and active and you find nothing wrong about it, then I'm afraid our inner conscience has died in such a way that we have even lost the fact that we no longer have feelings. هَذِهِ الْحِمَالُ لَا حِمَالُ خَيْبَرُ. This is not the dates and the raisins we're transporting from Khaybar to Medina. This is wholesome. This is spiritual. One is a brick you carry in, you know what, cleaning your paving, or your wife got you to clean the storeroom after a long time, and suddenly you got your overall and you're cleaning up, which is good in its own place and has its merit. But one is you working directly in the cause of the construction of deen. So that was the practice of the noble Sahaba. May Allah give us that ability that while we're doing something, our tongues can be moist in the remembrance of Allah Ta'ala. So Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu comes up to the door. It's this old woman. It's the late hours of the night. The lantern is burning. I have a flash of an incident once when we were in Albania. We met a man about 85 years of age living in the city of Elbasan, and he mentioned they had lived through the most harsh form of communism which was unleashed on the Balkan regions. And he lived through that entire difficult period. And he said, during the month of Ramadan, if a light was on in the early mornings, that was an indication that suhoor was taking place. By implication, it meant it's a house of a believer. And next day, the house would be bulldozed and the believers killed. This is something he told us himself. Anyway, Umar radiallahu anhu comes close. She's carding her wool and she's singing along. Ala Muhammad salatul abrar salla alayka al mustafawn al akhyar qad kunta qawwaman bakiy al ashar ya layta shi'ri wal manaya atwar hal tajma'uni wa habibi ad dar.
Old woman, late hours of the night. Late hours today is synonymous to something unsavory. Late hours is synonymous to something incorrect. The light is on at the odd hour, Allah forbid, there's something, you know what, you smell a dead rat, something is not in order, something is not palatable, something is not kosher, something is not permissible. She said, Ala Muhammad Salatul Abrar, may the salutations of the noble descend upon Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Salla alayka al-mustafawn al-akhyar, may the pious, beloved, chosen servants of Allah send their blessed salutations and greetings upon you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Qad kunta qawwaman bakiy al ashar. You were the one who instilled values, morals and guidance in us. And how can I forget your crying, weeping and sobbing in the early hours of the morning? Ya layta shi'ri, ya layta shi'ri, wal manaya atwar, hal tajma'uni wa habibi ad-dar. Oh Allah, how I wish that in Jannah, as your Nabi will be ushered in, I wish there's some space that I can also enter alongside with your Nabi and have a location that I can have a glance at him in that Jannah. When Umar ibn Khattab heard this, baka, he started crying. He became so emotional that he could not contain himself. After a period of time, he gathered himself, qara al-baba alayha. The narration is Ibn Asakir makes mention of it, and it's in Kanz al-Ummal as well. He knocks the door on her. So she said, Waman ala al-bab, and who's at the door? And he replied and he said, Umar. Wow. Imagine Umar ibn Khattab at your door. Sometimes you are pleasantly surprised by a legend or a personality, or at times people feel overwhelmed by meeting you, and that's only because they don't know the deeper side of you, and they're ecstatic and elated, and for them it's a moment that, wow, who I've met, or you meet someone. Imagine there's a knock on the door. Who's it? It's Umar ibn Khattab. So she says, وَمَا لِي وَلِي عُمَرْ وَمَا يَأْتِي بِعُمَرْ هَذِهِ السَّاعَةِ. But what have I to do with Umar? Why are you at my door? And why at this moment? So Umar radiallahu anhu said, "Iftahi rahimakillah fala ba'sa alayk." Sister, open, you're in no trouble, all is good, please just open. So she obliges and complies and she opens the door. Umar radiallahu anhu enters and he says, "Ruddi alayya al-kalimati allati qulti anifa." Oh sister, these poems that you had composed and you were reminiscing over the era of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the last stanza in which you express your passion and hope, dream, vision and anticipation that you could be reunited with him in Jannah, can you read it along? So she reads it again and she says, "Ala Muhammad salatul abrar, salla alayka al-mustafawn al-akhyar, qad kunta qawwaman bakiy al-ashar. يا ليت شعري والمنايا أطوار هل تجمعني وحبيبي الدار." She reads through the poems. Umar radiallahu anhu says, "أسألك," I ask you, O sister, in the name of Allah, can you add on one stanza in that poem and ask Allah to include Umar also in that Jannat? La ilaha illallah. La ilaha illallah. It gives me a shiver in my back. La ilaha illallah. As'aluki an tudkhilini ma'akuma. Now these were women and Arabs, you know what poetry was in their nature. So she immediately composed a poem. Read the narration. She says, "Ya layta shi'ri wal manaya atwar, hal tajma'uni wa habibi ad-dar, wa umaru faghfir lahu ya ghaffar." Oh Allah, give me some space in that Jannah with your Nabi and make a niche and an opening for Umar also. فَرَضِيَ وَرَجَعَ He said, "Oh my sister, I am happy, I am happy. May Allah bless you." And he left. عَلَمَ يُوسُف بِنْ إِسْمَعِيلْ النَّبْهَانِ Before I mention that, an ayah comes to mind. Nobody can aptly describe the lofty rank of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam other than Allah himself in Quran. Everything else pales in the description or the endeavor to encapsulate or appreciate the profile of Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. A verse of the 15th juz of the Quran, 17th chapter, the 73rd verse. Allah speaks about one of the ploys, amongst the many ploys of the polytheists of Makkah. So instead of embracing the truth, they tried to divert the Prophet of Allah from the truth. You know, you have some students, their effort is to see others don't study. You have, and I can see a lot of my students or former students, so they don't learn and their passion is to see how others don't learn. So instead of obliging to the message of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they came with obnoxious intentions. They came with sinister motives. وَإِن كَادُوا لَيَسْتَفِزُّونَكَ وَإِن كَادُوا لَيَفْتِنُونَكَ عَنِ الَّذِي أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ لِتَفْتَرِيَ عَلَيْنَا غَيْرَهُ وَإِذًا لَاتَّخَذُوكَ خَلِيلًا Oh my word. This is academic language, but I hope I can simplify it. Let me give you a verbatim translation and then tell you the amazing grammar and the lofty rank of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that has been, discussed and described in this ayah. So I gave you the verse. It's a verse of the 15th juz, 17th chapter, verse 73, Surah Bani Israel. Allah says, وَإِن In here, as the scholars of tafsir will tell us, مُخَفَّف مِنَ الْمُثَقَّلِ It's in the meaning of surely, definitely, absolutely. Kadu is what we refer to as huruf muqaraba. وَإِن كَادُوا Surely, the polytheists were close. They were on the verge. لَيَفْتِنُونَكَ لَيَفْتِنُونَكَ مَدَارِكُ التَّنْزِيلِ لَيَخْدَعُونَكَ They wanted to deceive you. بَيَانُ الْقُرْآنِ لَيَصْرِفُونَكَ They wanted to divert you away. So what happened? They came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and they said to him, "Listen, we'll sit with you, the prominent, the elite, the high profile, but you need to do away with the poor. Sitting with the poor is not becoming. We can't share a common table. It's below our dignity, our pride, our profile. We sit with high flyers. You know what? We're not comfortable." That's one explanation given. Another one is, we will listen to you if you can just tone down on the condemnation of polytheism in the Quran. So either do away with those verses or avoid it. اِئْتِ بِقُرْآنٍ غَيْرِ هَذَا أَوْ بَدِّلْ. And if you were to succumb and to surrender to this dictate of theirs, O Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, وَإِذَنْ أَيْلَوْ فَعَلْتَ لَتَّخَذُوكَ خَلِيلًا, they would have made you their intimate friend. They came with a proposal, they came with a request, they came with a passion and an agenda. If you had to surrender, succumb, buckle under pressure, accede to their request, they would have made you their intimate friend. But we didn't allow you to even incline to that, because you're our intimate friend. You are our friend. Now, it tells us, and this is in Tafsir Uthmani, it's a bit academic, but inshallah you'll appreciate it, the lofty rank of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Allah said that this is what they came with. وَإِذَنْ لَتَّخَذُوكَ خَلِيلًا وَلَوْلَا أَنْ ثَبَّتْنَاكَ. I ask for your undivided attention. وَلَوْلَا أَنْ ثَبَّتْنَاكَ. And if we did not keep you firm, so we put the help, the intervention, the assistance of Allah on hold momentarily. If Allah did not intervene, then what would have happened? وَلَوْلَا أَنْ ثَبَّتْنَاكَ لَقَدْ كِتَّ تَرْكَنُوا إِلَيْهِمْ شَيْئًا قَلِيلًا. La ilaha illallah. La ilaha illallah. La ilaha illallah. If Allah doesn't help me, I'm gone. I often say in my du'as, Allah, I don't even have the courage to ask you to reward me for the good I perform, because I believe you gave me the ability and the intention and the tawfiq. So I don't even, wallahi I say this, and this is not any superficial, Allah, I don't even have the courage to say reward me for a supposed good, because from inception to culmination, it was purely, exclusively, totally the help of Allah. He gave you the ability, He gave you the wealth, He gave you the strength, He inspired you, He made it possible. So like, where can I claim credit? But look at the personality and the purity of the nature of a Nabi, and this is in Tafsir Uthmani. So if we put the help of Allah on hold with their persistent requests, you are so clean and pure and protected, O Nabi of Allah, tarkan, you would have inclined. Rukun in Arabic means adna, a slight tilt of the heart, mailul qalb. So your heart would have tilt slightly. That's the word rukun. Then Allah said shay'an, Allah reduced that slightly even more. Then Allah said qaleelan, and Allah reduced it even more. Your thought or inclination would have been very mild. Then Allah reduced it even more by saying laqad kitta. Allah didn't say you would incline, you would probably, perhaps, somewhat, slightly incline, if you understand in the language. I'm giving you translation, it's not a nahwa lesson. You would probably, you know, now there's that Nahwi student that I was reading in the kitab, النحو شؤم كله يذهب بالخير من البيت خير من النحو وأصحابه ثريدة تعمل بالزيت. Those who know it, those who don't know, whatever. So Allah says that you would have only come somewhat slightly close. Jalalain says لشدة احتيالهم. And that's also because of their treacherous nature. But we protected you, and your nature is so clean. Brothers, look at ourselves, how vulnerable, how susceptible we are. Allah speaks about one type of people, that they're so vulnerable, they surrender to every dictate of the devil. كُتِبَ عَلَيْهِ أَنَّهُ مَنْ تَوَلَّاهُ فَأَنَّهُ يُضِلُّ. Some are such in Tanbihul Ghafilin, under the chapter of Anbiya, there is a discussion where Anbiya met Iblis. In that there is a discussion of Yahya alayhi salam met Iblis, and he had a dialogue. So he asked him, what are the different types of people? So Shaitan told Yahya alayhi salam, one category is كَالْكُرَةِ فِي أَيْدِي سِبْيَانِكُمْ, like a ball in the hand of a child. He can hit the ball, he can kick the ball, he can flip the ball. That's how one category of humans are in my control. May Allah protect us. I can make them lie, drink, distort, commit zina, and then justify any crime I want, they surrender. May Allah protect us. But the purity of Nabi alayhi salam is such, the purity of Nabi alayhi salam is such, Allah said, if I did not rescue you, you would have only probably my incline towards them slightly. But due to your lofty rank, I rescued you and I did not even allow you to incline in your thoughts to their dictates. Now see what Hakim al-Ummah writes in, but I haven't started the talk. No, after this I want to start formally, inshallah. In Bayan al-Quran, Hakim al-Ummah writes, my word, la ilaha illallah. He says, Nassun fi anna ismata Allahi hiya al-hafidh, lal quwwatun nafsiyya. Fa'idha kana hadha fi sha'ni sayyidir rasikhin, fa'kayfa bika ya miskin, wa kayfa taghtarru بتقدسك ونسبتك الباطنة التي عسى أن تكون مزعومة موهومة. Oh my word. Oh my word. He sends an alert, a red flag, caution, beware, be vigilant. Allah says to his Nabi, in the end, we rescued you. He writes, if the means of the rescue of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam from the provocation and the dictate of the polytheist was the intervention of Allah, then, oh foolish human, how can you dare rave or brag about your supposed piety? It doesn't even say piety, supposed. كيف تغتر بتقدسك, your nobility, your piety. ونسبتك الباطن, I have this nobility, this link, this station, التي عسى أن تكون مزعومة موهومة, which could just probably be. And often we have a notion that we have a particular station of piety, and our cronies, they just fan that as well. No, no, you are that man. I mean, you know what? Who can dare? So our ego gets inflated even more. Our ego gets inflated even more. Anyway, I was saying to you, Allama Yusuf bin Ismail al-Nabhani writes in his kitab, Wasa'il al-Wusul ila Shama'il al-Rasul. There's this beautiful quotation, and I want to set my tone going forward on this topic. وَمَنْ تَأَمَّلَ حُسْنَ تَدْبِيرِهِ لِلْعَرَبِ أَلَّذِينَ هُمْ كَالْوَحْشِ الشَّارِدِ مَعَ الطَّبِعِ الْمُتَنَافِرِ الْمُتَبَاعِدِ وكيف ساسهم واحتمل جفاهم وصبر على أذاهم إلى أن انقادوا إليه واجتمعوا عليه وهجروا في رضاه أوطانهم من غير ممارسة سبقت له ولا مطالعة كتب يتعلم منها سير الماضين تحقق له أنه صلى الله عليه وسلم أعقل العالمين. Anybody who pauses and reflects and introspects and puts his thinking cap on and understands the prophetic methodology, woman, the one, ta'ammal, reflects, husna tadbirihi, the amazing reflection, interaction, engagement of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam lil arab, to the Arab nation, alladhina hum kal wahshi sharid, who were like wild animals that were let loose, that bolted, ma'a tab'il mutanafiril mutaba'id, which had a hostile nature, ever ready to clash and argue and assault, wa kayfa sasahum واحتمل جفاهم وصبر على أذاهم, and how systematically he governed them, he regulated them, he tamed them, and then he persevered their ill behavior, he endured their harsh nature until they became his devoted, devout disciples, to the extent واختاروه على أنفسهم, they said, we prefer you over ourselves. O Nabi of Allah, we want your belly to be satiated before ours. We want your thirst to be quenched before us. You need to be in comfort. The famous statement of Zayd bin Dathina when he was about to be executed and Abu Sufyan was present. He said, you rave about the man, you're going to be executed. Don't you wish you could be at home and he could be here? And he said, مَا أُحِبُّ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا أَلْآنَ فِي مَكَانِهِ الَّذِي هُوَ فِيهِ وَتُصِيبُهُ شَوْكَةٌ تُؤْذِيهِ وَأَنِّي جَالِسٌ فِي أَهْلِي. I wouldn't want the Prophet of Allah to be pricked by a thorn. I'll give my life to offset the pricking of a thorn. Today a man is sitting and asking, vacate that place for your father. Okay, you know, yeah, all right, I'm comfortable. Inshallah, we'll find a place. I wouldn't want to vacate my place for my dad or my senior or my mentor or any prominent personality. I would put my life on the line to avoid a thorn pricking Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Min ghayri mumarasatin sabaqat lahu. The Prophet of Allah didn't study the books of any previous reformers or coach or leaders. Wala mutala'ati kutubin yata'allamu minha sir al-madin. تحقق له أنه صلى الله عليه وسلم أعقل العالمين. You will be compelled to acknowledge that he صلى الله عليه وسلم was the noblest human that inhabited earth in its entire history. My focus today, moving from here, is how the Prophet of Allah changed the environment. He changed the landscape. In an environment of hostility and antagonism, how he brought about brotherhood and unity. And my focus is think big and create a change in an environment. Huzaifa ibn Yaman radiallahu anhu says, the hadith is in Bukhari, وَلَقَدْ أَتَى عَلَيَّ زَمَانٌ وَمَا أُبَالِي أَيَّكُمْ بَايَعْتُ لَإِنْ كَانَ مُسْلِمًا لَيَرُدَّنَّهُ عَلَيَّ دِينُهُ وَلَإِنْ كَانَ يَهُودِيًّا أَوْ نَصْرَانِيًّا لَيَرُدَّنَّهُ عَلَيَّ سَعِيهِ. I remember how the Prophet of Allah transformed Arabia, that in his blessed era, I could deal with anyone and everyone without asking for a reference check on him. If he was a believer, his faith was of a level that it would protect him from uttering a lie. And if he was a disbeliever, the governor will never harbor him or give him shelter or amnesty. He will expose him. So I could deal with anyone and everyone. There was only honesty across the board. Imagine an environment of absolute honesty. Make the mark, change the environment. Today the norm has become such, what they say, tum chaho ya na chaho, mil jayega. Doke uruj pe hai. Tum chaho ya na chaho, mil jayega. Whether you desire or not, you request or not, you'll get it. Why deception, delusion is on the incline, it's on the increase. It's a world of deception and delusion. That's how it's happening. Kana Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam idha amsa. Try and picture this era. And the focus is change the environment. Kana Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam idha amsa qassama nasam min ahli suffa bayna nasim min ashabihi. Every evening, can you imagine in that masjid of Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there were these poor sahaba who were held back, who would rally around the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In fact, many ulama say, they reference in this verse, lil fuqara alladhina uhsiru fi sabilillah la yastati'una darban fil ard yahsabuhumul jahilu aghniya min at-ta'affuf ta'rifuhum bisimahum la yas'aluna an-nasa ilhafa. And charity should be directed lil fuqara, to the poor, alladhina hu uhsiru, who were restrained, who were held back, they didn't have finance, who they couldn't travel on the earth because they were in Masjid an-Nabawi. They would rally around the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yahsabuhumul jahilu aghniya'a min at-ta'affuf. Wow, look at the dignity of Islam. Despite their poverty and their penury, despite their adversity and their difficulty, an onlooker would perceive them to be affluent or wealthy simply because they never stretch their hand. Dignity, carry yourself with dignity. Ta'rifuhum bisimahum. But you will recognize them with the signs of humility and poverty if you look deeper. In Qurtubi, under this ayah, it's written, the ayah releases a hint that in the absence of tangible proof, we will act on apparent symbols. So if a corpse is found and it was not circumcised and there's no beard or symbol of a believer, we will not dignify this corpse with a Muslim burial. That's the exact example given in Qurtubi. So I'm not giving my own example. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would return at night. The people of Suffa are sitting. Imagine this environment. We've decided to live a life of luxury, the consequences of which is others are deprived of a life of necessity. That's the brutal truth. The other day I was driving and then there was a beggar and I gave something and another beggar came and I gave something and then a third beggar and then I said, oh man, I wish I had more. And then I said, but how are we going to rescue this world? This thought just came to me and I'm having this auto-suggestion in my mind. And then Allah put the thought in my mind, the problem is we only want to help with surplus. That's why we're not making any progress. So I can't compromise my meal or my vacation or my outing or my new refurbishing. If there's anything surplus or additional or extra, then probably, perhaps, maybe I will help. That's why we're not moving forward. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam would then distribute the Ashabi Suffa amongst his other Sahaba for dinner. We told you of an environment of honesty. In your home, in your place, in your work, create an atmosphere of honesty. Now look at an environment of hospitality. So Nabi alayhi salam would say, right, there are so many people of Suffa, who can take them home? فَكَانَ الرَّجُلُ يَذْهَبُ بِالرَّجُلِ وَالرَّجُلُ يَذْهَبُ بِالرَّجُلَيْنِ وَالرَّجُلُ يَذْهَبُ بِالثَّلَاثَةِ حَتَّى ذَكَرَ عَشْرًا فَكَانَ سَعْدُ بْنُ عُبَادَ يَرْجِعُ كُلَّ لَيْلَةٍ بِثَمَانِينَ مِنْهُمْ يُعَشِّيهِمْ. What an environment, my Allah. So one said, oh Nabi of Allah, give me one, I'll take one home. Another one, oh Nabi of Allah, I'll take two. Oh Nabi of Allah, you can give me three. Oh Nabi of Allah, you can give me 10. And Sa'd ibn Ubadah said, oh Nabi of Allah, you can keep 80 for me every night. They'll have supper by my place. Oh Nabi of Allah, you can keep no formality, no protocol, nothing lavish, nothing flamboyant, simple, but they come in home and they take in barakah. What was that environment? Tabrani makes mention of the narration. Rabi'a ibn Ka'b radiallahu anhu says, Kuntu akhdumu Nabiya sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I was the servant of Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam. Faqala li yawma. One day he said to me, Ya Rabi'a, ala tazawwaj, ay ala tatazawwaj. Rabi'a, you don't want to get married. And from here, let me pause again. My mind runs in different deductions. The Prophet of Allah was not only concerned about the spiritual well-being, he was also concerned about the worldly matters of a person. While the hidayat of an individual is priority, and that's paramount importance, it doesn't mean we shy away when it comes to finding employment for a person, when it comes to finding shelter for a person. Nabi alayhi salam realized this was his servant, time is coming close, he's moving on, it's time to settle down. Ala tazawwaj, Rabi'a, you don't want to get married? So he gave three replies. Ma uhibbu an atazawwaj, ma indi ma yuqimu al-mar'a, wa ma uhibbu an yashghalani anka shay. Oh Nabi of Allah, I don't think I really want to get married. And even if I want to, I don't have enough money to take care of a woman. Who really has? Ma indi ma yuqimu al-mar'a, I don't think I have adequate funds to take care of a woman. And number three, ma uhibbu an yashghalani anka shay, I don't want anything to divert me or distract me or preoccupy me from serving you. فَأَعْرَضَ عَنِّي. Look at the demeanor. Look at the interaction. Nabi Sassam said, okay. He left me. Time moved on after a little while. Ya Rabi'a, Allah tazawwaj. Rabi'a, you don't want to get married. I said, oh Nabi of Allah, I stand my grounds. Ma uridu an atazawwaj, ma indi ma yuqimu al-mar'a, ma uhibbu an yashghalani anka shay. I don't think I'm ready. I don't have adequate funds and I don't want to compromise in my service to you. He left me. That night I retired to bed. The narration is in Tabrani, Rijaluhu, Rijalu Sahih. The entire narration is authentic. I don't want to go into the academics, but just for comfort to know it's an authentic narration. I retired to bed. I said to myself, Raja'tu ila nafsi faqultu, Inna Rasulallah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam a'lamu minni bima yasluhuni fi dunya wal akhirah. Allah's Nabi surely knows what is good for me. If he's repeatedly telling me, Rabi'a, get married, maybe I should stop resisting the proposal and realize it's time to get married. Wallahi la in qala li, this is first marriage. No, many people think, no. La in qala li, now if he tells me, why don't you get married? La aqulanna na'am, murni bima shi'at. If he tells me, oh Rabi'a, why don't you get married? I'm going to say, I'm ready. Now I came back and I'm waiting. A day passed, nothing. Then I came, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, Ala tazawwaj, Rabi'a, why don't you get married? I say, Murni bima shi'at. Oh Nabi of Allah, I'm ready, you make a call. Now, there are many people in our society, hey brother, why don't you get married? Hey, not now. And again, why don't you get married? Okay, I'm ready. Hey, Allah make it easy for you, Shaykh. He backs off. I'm done. Hey, why don't you buy a new car? And hey, you know what? They're buying property here, they're leasing here, there's a good flat, there's a good investment opportunity. I'm telling you, you snooze, you lose. Okay, create a contact, give a loan. Allah help you, my brother. Allah be with you. Look at the narration. Create an environment, change. I said, imagine an environment, everyone is honest. You don't have to do a reference check on anyone. Imagine there's no person that goes hungry in Medina. Everybody takes it as pride to see how he can support, aid, and feed the next person. Now look at this environment. A young man is growing. He's of age now. His growth, his prosperity is the pride of every member of society. You tell me. I'm ready. اذهب إلى آل فلان من الأنصار وقل لهم إن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يأمركم أن تزوجوني فلانا. Go to this Ansar tribe, and in that Ansar tribe there's this clan, and tell them Allah's Nabi has sent you, and they must marry you to this woman from amongst them. لا إله إلا الله لا إله إلا الله. فذهبت إليهم وقلت لهم إن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يأمركم أن تزوجوني فلانا. I know you're going to listen attentively, it's on marriage, but as a whole, to understand the society. Keep focus, brothers, keep focus. I come to them, I said, Allah's Nabi has sent me, and he has told me that you should wed me and marry me to this daughter from your tribe. فَقَالُوا مَرْحَبًا بِرَسُولِ اللَّهِ وَبِرَسُولِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ وَاللَّهِ لَا يَرْجِعُ رَسُولُ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ إِلَّا بِحَاجَتِهِ. Welcome to the Nabi of Allah, and welcome to the envoy of the Nabi of Allah. By Allah, neither the Nabi of Allah nor will his envoy return with anything less than what they request. فزوجوني وألطفوني وما سألوني البينة. Rabbi, I can't imagine what did my Nabi transform Arabia to. And with the Sahaba and the Tabi'een, the legacy continued. فَزَوَّجُونِي وَأَلْتَفُونِي. These people wedded me. وَأَكْرَمُونِي بِالْهَدَايَا. They didn't ask me for proof or testimony or evidence. They performed the nikah, solemnized the marriage. فَرَجَعْتُ إِلَىٰ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ حَزِينًا. I came back to Nabi alayhi salam, but I was down and I was gloomy. Imagine care, concern for one member of the ummah. So he said, Ya Rabi'atu, ma laka hazin? Oh Rabi'a, you still looking sad, you got married, what happened? You know the person who went to the doctor and asked for an antidepressant. So he said, no, you got to give a prescription letter. So he says, your marriage certificate. He says, no, you're kidding me. We need a prescription letter. You can't just say you're married. You know what I mean? You need antidepressant. You need a proper. Salim? فَرَجَعْتُ إِلَىٰ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ. I came to Nabi alayhi salam hazin. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَا لَكَ حَزِينَ يَا رَبِيَا رَبِيَا. You're looking very sad. He said, أَتَيْتُ قَوْمًا كِرَامًا زَوَّجُونِي وَأَلْطَفُونِي وَمَا سَأَلُونِي الْبَيِّنَ وَلَيْسَ عِنْدِي الصَّدَاقِ. Oh, Nabi of Allah, these people were so amazing. This Ansar, this tribe, this community, this locality, this area is so amazing. I went there, I told them, you sent me, they accepted me. I said, I'm the messenger. They said, welcome. I said, this woman, they said, perfect. The nikah was performed. But then I realized I don't have dowry. Nabi Allah said, no, Rom, Ya Buraida, Ya Buraida. Now, Buraida was the leader of the Aslam tribe. And if you read the narration of Tabrani, when Nabi Sassam was coming to Medina, Buraida with 80 people were potential assassins to kill Nabi alayhi salam. And they came close to Nabi alayhi salam, and then they were intercepted. And then Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, what's your name? So he said, Buraida. Now in Islam, we don't believe in bad omen, but we believe in good omen. We believe in good omen as in we deduce good omen from situations and names, etc. So Baruda is derived from the word Bard, which means cool. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, your name is Buraida. Oh, Abu Bakr, Baruda Amruna. Our matter is cooled off now. The whole tension is just relaxed. Then Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, from which tribe you come? He said, from Bani Aslam. So Aslam has the root word of Salima, which means safety. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Salimna, then we're safe. He said, from which branch of this tribe? He said, Bani Saham. Saham can mean share or arrow. Then Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Kharaja sahmuka fil Islam. Then your share in Islam is confirmed. and he read the kalima. And his 80 people accepted his authentic narration. Then he became part of the entourage to enter and usher Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam into Medina. And he was the leader of the tribe. My message is change the environment from lies and deception, from treachery and selfishness to generosity and selflessness. Nabi Sassam said, Buraida yulati ijma'u lahu wazna nawatim min zahab. Gather some gold the size of a date pit for our Rabia. Rabia is married, please. You people make a plan and get some dowry for him. I was reading in Mirqat, the Sharah of Mishkat, Mullah Ali Qari Rahmatullah Ali writes, why sadaq? Ijma'u lahu wazna nawatim min zahab. Fa'ataytu fa'akhadtu ma jama'u li. فأتيت به النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال اذهب بهذا إليهم وقل لهم هذا صدقها. I gathered that gold. They made an effort. One man needs to get married. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, right, gather. We said, okay, O Nabi of Allah, we work in. They worked together. They pooled their resources. They got gold equivalent to the size of a date pit. Gold equivalent to the size of a date pit. I took it. I came to Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, go to your family and give it to your wife and tell her this is her dowry. So in Arabic, you refer to dowry as sadaq. And this is the beauty of the language. Mullah Ali Qari Rahmatullah Ali writes it. وَسُمِّيَ بِهِ صَدَاق لِأَنَّهُ يَصْدُقُ بِهِ مَيْلُ الرَّجُلِ إِلَى امْرَأَتِهِ. So sadaq is derived from the word sadaqah. Sadaqah means truthful. And the dowry is a testimony of your sincerity to the bond of marriage. So the pagan Arab had two issues in marriage amongst others. A, they would not give the dowry to the woman. They would give it to some guardian. Allah stopped that practice and said, give it to her. And they would give it reluctantly. Allah said, give it happily. وَآتُ النِّسَاءَ صَدُقَاتِهِنَّ نِحْلَةِ وَآتُ النِسَاءَ. And I have a flash of an ayat that I read. I mean, the commentary in Bayanul Quran, just an objective digression. Allah speaks about His many favors. It's academic, but I'll try and simplify it. So Allah says, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَنْ خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا. Amongst the many signs that reflect the qudrat of Allah. Generally, when we speak in about the power and the qudra and the greatness of Allah, we talk of the sky and the earth. Nobody talks of marriage. You ever heard brothers, you know what, talk on the qudrat and iman and yaqeen and talk on marriage? But Allah is saying that. وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَيْ أَدَّلَّ عَلَى قُدْرَتِهِ. Amongst the proof of the existence of Allah is أَنْ خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا. Allah's created spouses for you. In Bayanul Quran, under this ayah is written, دَلَالَةٌ عَلَى كَوْنِ مَيْلَانِ الرِّجَالِ إِلَى الْأَزْوَاجِ مِنْ مِنَنِهِ تَعَالَى لِأَنَّهُ ذَكَرَهُ فِي مَحَلِّ الْإِمْتِنَانِ وَدَلَّ أَيْضًا عَلَى عَدَمِ التَّنَافِي بَيْنَهُ وَبَيْنَ الْكَمَالِ كَمَا يَزْعُمُهُ بَعْضُ الْمُتَقَشِّفِينَ مِنَ الزُّهَادِ. Oh man, what do I say? Dalalatun ala kawni maylani rijal ila al-azwaj min minanihi ta'ala. The natural inclination that a male has towards a woman is from the bounties of Allah, because Allah has highlighted it in the context of bounty. You know what that guy said? My wife, she's my strength, and other women are my weaknesses. That's a loud laughter, Masuman. مِن مِنَنِهِ تَعَالَى لِأَنَّهُ ذَكَرَهُ فِي مَحَلِّ الْإِمْتِنَانِ. Because Allah's highlighted it in the context of a favor. وَدَلَّ أَيْضًا عَلَى عَدَمِ التَّنَافِي بَيْنَهُ وَبَيْنَ الْكَمَالِ. And it doesn't contradict the station of nobility, because Allah has highlighted it. It's intrinsic, it's inherent, it's part of your DNA. كَمَا يَزْعَمُهُ بَعْضُ الْمُتَقَشِّفِينَ مِنَ الزُّهَادِ. How some self-denying ascetics will assume and claim it. Anyway, they gathered the dowry. Wow. You work and he needs to give. The whole environment is working. Everyone. We now, someone else is getting married. I hope they invite me. Yeah. I want to see now who they invited. That's my job. To sit back and see who's coming, what they feed in, how many people. Yeah, the whole community is working so one person can get married. So that was the era of Nabuwat of Nabi alayhi salatu was salam. فَأَخَذْتُ مَا جَمَعُوا لِي. I took it. I came to Nabi alayhi salam. Nabi sallallahu alayhi salam said, go to them and give it. So I went to them and I said, هَذَا صَدَاقُهَا. This is her dowry. فَقَبِلُوهُ وَرَضُوهُ وَقَالُوا كَثِيرٌ طَيِّبٌ. They said, oh, so much dowry. MashaAllah, so much. Where do you ever hear so much? Just look at the environment. فَرَجَعْتُ إِلَىٰ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ حَزِينًا. The narration goes on, I came back, I was still gloom, I was still sad, I was depressed. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, مَا لَكَ يَا رَبِيعَةُ. Oh Rabi'ah, what's the matter? You still looking sad? We, if we say, hey, now this guy is too sad, I'm not going to even ask him. If I'm going to ask here, I'm going to get involved more. This is my nature. This is my environment. Rabi'ah, what's the matter? Ya Rasulallah, مَا رَأَيْتُ قَوْمًا أَكْرَمَ مِنْهُمْ. These in-laws of mine are so amazing, so hospitable, so accommodating. وَلَيْسَ عِنْدِي مَا أُولِمْ. And I just thought that I can also honor the sunnah of walima, but I don't have money for dowry. Where can I have? Ya Burayda, ijma'u lahu shatan. Burayda, gather your friends again. Just call on them. We need some money. We need to put together. Buy him a nice goat. La ilaha illallah. La ilaha illallah. Fajama'u li kabshan azima. These words are amazing. They then gathered the money and they decided to buy me the most healthy, fat and good shaped goat. Not because it's voluntary, it's optional, so give him anything. I mean, we're giving him free. He can't tell us it's skinny. No. This is the thing. Allah speaks of Dhul Qarnain in the Quran. When he traveled and he came to a nation and they said, إِنَّ يَأَجُوجَ وَمَأَجُوجَ مُفْسِدُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ فَهَلْ نَجَعَلُ لَكَ خَرْجًا. Oh, Dhul Qarnain, we've got this nation that's invading us. Can you build a defensive wall or a bulwark for us, as they would say, to separate us? And we will give you revenue. He said, I don't want revenue. Why must I exploit you and milk you? Allah's given me enough money, but help me. Help me. Atuni zubar al hadid. Give me chunks of iron. Hatta idha sawa bayna sadafain. Then he leveled it up between the cliffs of the two mountains. And then he ignited it. And then he said, blow. Qala atuni ufrigh alayhi qitra. Then he said, give me, and by the way, for those into Nahwa, the Mufassirin say, in Qitra, this Tanazwe Fi'lan. Those who know Tanazwe Fi'lan, Huzif al-awwal li dalalati thani alayh. And he, atuni Qitra, ufrigh alayhi Qitra. It's academic, anyway. Atuni ufrigh alayhi Qitra. Give me molten copper. Give me molten copper, and then he poured it. Now, he was doing something voluntarily, but he built such a wall without taking remuneration. He said, فَمَسْتَطَاعُوا أَن يَظْهَرُوهُ وَمَسْتَطَاعُوا لَهُ نَقْبًا. I'm happy to tell you, I have built a wall, they will never scale and they will never tunnel through. We can't give that service when people pay us. The man pays you and the shoelace breaks as you walk out of the shop. This is voluntary. فَجَمَعُوا لِي كَبْشًا. Understand the society. I'm saying change the environment. That was the sunnah of my Habib. Make an impact. They gathered money. They bought me a nice goat. I took the goat and I came to Nabi alayhi salam. He said, اِذْهَبْ إِلَىٰ عَائِشَةَ فَقُلْ لَهَا فَلْتَبْعَثْ بِالْمِكْتَلْ أَلَّذِي فِيهِ الطَّعَامِ. Now you go to my house, not to Burayda, not to anyone. Tell Aisha whatever food is in the basket, she must give it. I came, I knocked on the door. My mother Aisha opened. She ushered me in. I said, the Nabi of Allah has sent me that you should kindly give me the basket. She said, Fihi sab'u asu' min sha'ir. There are 7 sa', which is a measure of barley in this basket. By Allah, there's no other grain of food in our house. But if Allah's Nabi told you, please take it happily and go. That's why I can't help everyone. Why? My children must have a lavish holiday. My home must be refurbished. I must upgrade my car. And then I want to help someone who's sleeping outside on the road. And then if there's some leftover food from the takeaway, then probably I'll drop it by. But not at the cost on encroaching on my life or my pocket in any way. Nobody can be more distant from the sunnah of Habib sallallahu alaihi wasallam than us. I took fa'ataytu. I came to Nabi alayhi salam with the goat and what Aisha radiallahu anha gave. Look at the environment. Nabi alayhi salam said, اِذْهَبْ بِهَذَا إِلَيْهِمْ فَقُلْ لَهُمْ لِيُصْبِحْ هَذَا عِنْدَكُمْ خُبْزًا وَهَذَا طَبِيخًا. Now you take this goat and this barley and you go to your in-laws. Tell them they must roast the goat and they must bake the bread and then we have the walima. You say, no, how can I go to my in-law? What they'll think? The son-in-law is putting pressure from the word go.
There was no...
A lot of people have... You went to go see the girl. Yeah. You like her. Yeah. Propose. No, you mustn't propose immediately. They think you're desperate. Yeah. No, you don't propose immediately. You must wait. Apribi izzat che nakno maslo. So this is what has eroded us, paralyzed us, incapacitated us, destroyed us. Yeah, don't give the answer now. You must take your time. So I came to my in-laws. I said, لِيُصْبِحَذَا عِنْدَكُمْ خُبْزْ وَهَذَا طَبِيخَ. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi said, you must roast this and you must bake this. They said, أَمَّا الْخُبْزُ فَسَنَكْفِيكُمُ وَأَمَّا الْكَبْشُ فَكْفُونَا أَنْتُمْ. Listen, the bread we know how to bake. This goat, you and your family can roast it. So we said, no problem. So I took the goat. As soon as the news got in my tribe that the goat is back to me, فَأَخَذْنَا الْكَبْشَ أَنَا وَأُنَاسٌ مِّنْ أَسْلَمْ. My family and my tribe came and they said, no problem. فَذَبَحْنَاهُ وَسَلَخْنَاهُ وَطَبَخْنَاهُ. So then we took the goat, we slaughtered the goat, we skinned the goat, we roast the goat. My in-laws made the bread and then the food was prepared. And guess who was our chief guest? فَأَوْلَمْتُ فَدَعُوتُ النَّبِيَّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. I said, oh Nabi of Allah, tomorrow is my walima. He said, I will be there. La ilaha illallah. Can you imagine that walima? The whole community rallied. I have another flash of an incident I want to continue with this year. Look at how time is just running away. Abu Wada'a, one of his contemporaries says that Abu Wada'a narrated this incident to me himself. He says, حدثني أبو وداعة كنت ألازم مسجد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم طلبا للعلم. Abu Wada'a says, I used to attend the gathering of Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم. So the legacy continued, this change of environment, this positive energy that was transmitted. So I used to attend the gathering of Nabi عليه السلام وكنت أزاحم على حلقة الشيخ. And I used to be there early to attend the discourses of Sa'id ibn Musayyib. So one day I was absent. فتفقدني وظن أن بي مرض أو عرض لي عارض. So the Sheikh was concerned that where's Abu Wada'a? I don't see him. So after a few days I came back. فلما دخلت, when I entered, حياني ورحب بي. He welcomed me, he ushered me in. He said, أين كنت يا أبا Wada'a? Oh Abu Wada'a, a few days I didn't see you. He said, توفيت زوجتي فاشتغلت بأمرها. My wife passed away, so I was attending to the rituals and the burial. So that's why I couldn't come to class. So Sa'id ibn Musayyib, who was my teacher, he said, هَلَّا أَخْبَرْتَنَا فَنُوَاسِيَكَ وَنَشْهَدَ جَنَازَتَهَا مَعَكَ وَنُعِينَكَ عَلَى مَا أَنْتَ فِيهِ. But why didn't you tell us that your wife passed away? We could attend the rituals, burial, assist you, support you, morally comfort you. I said, جَزَاكَ اللَّهُ خَيْرًا. I appreciate your sentiments, your empathy. May Allah reward you. وَهَمَمْتُ أَنْ أَقُومُ. And I decided to leave as the gathering had concluded and people were dispersing. فَاسْتَبْقَانِي. He said, Abu Wada'a, I need to talk to you. So I said, okay. حَتَّى انصرف جَمِيعُ. This was a tabi'i. That environment. Be the first one. 2 years ago, I read an article when I had just come back from the Rohingya camps that a couple here in South Africa got married and they didn't have a walima and they took their money and they had the walima in the Rohingya camps. Wow. That's changing the moral compass. Can you imagine the du'as of those people for that progeny and that couple? So when everybody left, he said to me, أَمَا فَكَّرْتَ فِي اسْتِحْدَاثِ زَوْجَةٍ لَكَ يَا أَبَا وَدَاعَ. Abu Wada'a, you just told me your wife passed away. I'm like, yes. Have you given thought to getting married again? I said, وَمَنْ يُزَوِّجُنِي إِبْنَتَهُ وَأَنَا شَابٌ نَشَأَ يَتِيمًا وَأَنْشَ فَقِيرًا فَأَنَا لَا أَمْلِكُ غَيْرَ دِرْهَمَيْنِ. Your Majesty, Your Excellency, my Ustad, may Allah bless you. Jazakallah. There was an environment of everything, caring for the education and the well-being. Who would dare give me his daughter? Because I grew up as an orphan, and if I look in my pocket, maximum I got 2 dirhams. So Sa'id ibn Musayyib said, I'm asking you because I want to give you my daughter. And you know who was his daughter? I read it myself. Siyaru a'lam in nubala. Anna Sa'id ibn Musayyib lazama Aba Huraira. Fakana a'lamu an-nasi bi hadithi Abi Huraira. حتى تزوج من بنت ابن هريرة. that Sa'id ibn Musayyab was the close disciple of Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu. He was the most knowledgeable with regards to the hadith of Abu Hurairah. In the end, Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu wedded his daughter to Sa'id ibn Musayyab. So you're talking of the granddaughter of Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu. So I said, Anta tuzawwijuni ibnatak ba'da an arafta min amri ma araft, like you want to marry me to your daughter after you heard. He said, yes. فَنَحْنُ إِذَا جَاءَنَا مَنْ نَرْضَى دِينَهُ وَخُلُقَهُ زَوَّجْنَاهُ وَأَنْتَ عِنْدَنَا مَرْضِيُّ الدِّينِ وَالْخُلُقُ. Because the yardstick, the benchmark, the credentials by us is nobility and character, and I know you, you're my student, so I'm happy. So I'm like still puzzled. ثُمَّ الْتَفَتَ إِلَى مَنْ كَانَ قَرِيبًا مِنَّا. He looked around and he said, hey brother, come here, come here, come here. They all sat down. فحمد الله وأثنى عليه وصلى على نبيه محمد صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعقد لي على ابنته وجعل مهرها درهمين اثنين. He sat down, he solemnized the nikah, and then he said, you said 2 dirhams. Give me the 2 dirhams. That's the dowry for my daughter. فقمت وأنا لا أدري ما أقول من الدهشة والفرح. I got up, I'm crying and laughing. I'm like, hey, is this real or not? Am I married? Like, is this absolutely, has it happened? وَكُنْتُ يَوْمَ إِذٍ صَائِمًا. And by the way, that day I was fasting. Wow, that's a son-in-law. Can you imagine? Casually he was fasting. فَنَسِيتُ صَوْمِ. I forgot that I was fasting. And all day I'm telling myself that وَيْحَكَ يَا أَبَا وَدَعَ مِمَّنْ تَسْتَدِينَ وَمِمَّنْ تَطْلُبَ الْمَالِ أَبُو وَدَعَ. But do you think what you've done? Where are you going to borrow money from? And all day I'm running my thoughts. حتى ظللت على حالي هذه حتى أذن للمغرب. Until the sun set on the western horizon and the adhan was called out. صليت المكتوبة. I offered my maghrib prayer. جلست إلى فطوري. I sat down to eat. وكان خبزا وزيتا. My iftar was bread and was olive oil. ما إن تناولت منه لقمة أو لقمتين حتى سمعت الباب يقرأ. I had a morsel or two and there was a knock on the door. قلت من الطارق. I said, who's knocking at this hour? قال سعيد. He said, it's سعيد. لقد مر بخاطري كل إنسان اسمه سعيد أعرفه إلا سعيد بن المسيب. I said, this could be any سعيد and every سعيد but سعيد بن المسيب. وذلك أنه لم يرى منذ 40 سنة إلا بين بيته وبين المسجد. Because for 40 years this man was only seen in his masjid and in his house. ففتحت الباب. I opened the door. فإذا بي أمام سعيد. سعيد بن المسيب, my teacher and yeah, well, daddy, father-in-law for now. So in my heart I said, ظَنَنْتُ أَنَّهُ قَدْ بَدَى لَهُ فِي أَمْرِ زِوَاجِ مِنْ إِبْنَتِهِ بِشَيْءٍ. I said, yeah, I think in a happy moment he just got me married. Probably he went home. You know what? His wife didn't agree and he's coming here to cancel the whole thing. This is what I'm thinking in my mind. So I said, هَلَّا أَرْسَلْتَ إِلَيَّ فَآتِيَكَ. Why didn't you tell me, my teacher? I would have made my presence at your home. He said, بَلْ أَنْتَ أَحَقُّ بِأَنْ أَتِي إِلَيْكَ الْيَوْمِ. Actually, today, I ought to come to you. So I said, تَفَضَّلْ, then come in. He said, كَلَّا, no, not at all. So I said, then what's the matter? He said, إِنَّمَا جِئْتُ لِأَمْرٍ. I've just come to discuss one thing with you quickly. So I said, okay. He said, إِنَّ ابْنَتِي أَصْبَحَتْ زَوْجَةً لَكَ بِشَرْعِ اللَّهِ مُنْذُ الْغَدَاتِ وَأَنَا أَعْلَمُ أَنَّهُ لَيْسَ مَعَكَ أَحَدْ يُونِسُ وَحْشَتَكَ فَكَرِهْتُ أَنْ تَبِيتَ فِي مَكَانٍ وَتَبِيتُ زَوْجَتُكَ فِي مَكَانٍ آخَرٍ فَجِئْتُكَ بِهَا. I just thought that you alone, the nikah is performed, she's going to toss on her bed, you're going to toss on your bed, you lonely, she's lonely, you dream of her, she dreams of you. I said, let me bring her in. I said, وَيْحَكْ جِئْتَ بِهَا, you brought her? He said, yes. فَنَظَرْتُ فَإِذَا هِيَ قَائِمَةٌ بِطُولِهَا. I looked and lo and behold, there was my wife. This is how, somebody said, when nikah was simple, zina was difficult. Today we've made nikah difficult, so zina has become simple. We can't justify or condone it, but we've created hurdles. When nikah was simple, why would you opt for haram? Coming back to the hadith of Rabi'ah, he said, I got married, I was happy. Then Nabi alayhi salam, the environment. ثُمَّ إِنَّ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ أَعْطَانِي أَرْضًا. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, to give me economic stability, he gifted me a plot of land. Allahu Akbar. Empower. وَأَعْطَى أَبَا بَكْرٍ أَرْضًا. And he gave Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu also a land adjacent to my land. And he said, وَجَاءَتِ الدُّنْيَا. And then my days turned. Now Allah opened up the wealth of this world to me. Now it was a different Rabi'a. Now I was flying on a different wicket. May Allah bless my father and reward him and my mother and all our seniors. We have a family group, and on that my dad posts daily reminders. And one of his repeated reminders is every day, my children, his grandchildren are included, his daughter-in-laws and everyone, he impresses upon us all the time, don't forget your past days. Don't forget your past days. And remember, if someone is poor today, don't think he'll be poor forever. Allah can very quickly turn the table and reverse it on you. People who will shun you today, tomorrow they could be, you know what, situations of someone who snubs you, their children come to your child's door to collect zakat. This is the reality of the world. Nobody is anchored. Nobody is an anchored tenant here. Allah can evict anyone at any time. He said, Ja'ati dunya. Listen to this. Look at the environment. Oh, if I could block that clock. Ja'ati dunya. The world opened up upon me. ثُمَّ اخْتَلَفْنَا فِي عَذْقِ نَخْلَى. Then me and Abu Bakr got into an argument, radiallahu anhu, about a date palm. عَذْق. جَمْعُ عُذَّاق. We got into an argument. فَقُلْتُ أَنَا هِيَ فِي حَدِّي وَقَالَ أَبُو بَكْرٍ هِيَ فِي حَدِّي. So it was on the border of my plot and the border of Abu Bakr, and there was this date palm. So I said, no, this is in my property. So Abu Bakr said, no, this is my property. فَقَالَ لِي أَبُو بَكْرٍ كَلِمَةً كَرِهَهَا. So in that rage, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu said to me a statement which he lamented, which he regretted. Nadima, he regretted. He said, رُدَّ عَلَيَّ مِثْلَهَا حَتَّى يَكُونَ قِصَاصًا. Rabia, forgive me, that was distasteful, my apologies. Just retort and say the same thing back to me, so we balance the score. I said, مَا أَنَا بِفَاعِلْ. No, Abu Bakr, I respect you, but I am not going to say this. He said, لَتَقُولَنَّ أَوْ لَأَسْتَعْدِيَنَّ عَلَيْكَ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. Listen, Rabi'a, say that, or else I will report you to Nabi alayhi salam. So ista'da means to take help. I said, مَا أَنَا بِفَاعِلْ. Oh, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, I respect your position. This was a real life. There was arguments, there was altercations, there were differences. But see how they diffused it. Khalid bin Safwan says, Shahidtu Amr ibn Ubaidin. I'm coming back to this incident. Shahidtu Amr ibn Ubaidin. I was sitting with Amr ibn Ubaid. فَقَالَ لَهُ رَجُلْ. One person came and he started telling him nasty things. وَرَجُلٌ يَشْتِمُهُ وَيَسُبُّهُ. You like this, you wicked, you nasty, you evil. And you get a nice share of these emails. You know, may Allah bless everyone, may Allah guide everyone. I guess it's part of the package that so many will salute you and so many would find fault with you. And we need both for our own growth and development. May Allah grant us humility. May Allah let us do that with which we, in the end, we just need Allah to say, Ni'ma al-abd. Allah to recognize that we're good. That's it. Chapter close. Because that is the thing that really matters. So, Khalid bin Safwan says, I'm watching Amr bin Umayyad. When this man is telling him nasty things, he got up and he said, أَجَرَكَ اللَّهُ عَلَى مَا قُلْتَ مِنْ صَوَابٍ وَغَفَرَ لَكَ عَلَى مَا قُلْتَ مِنْ خَطَئٍ. May Allah reward you for all the good things you said about me, and may Allah forgive you for all the incorrect things you said about me. Khalid bin Safwan said, مَا حَسَدْتُ أَحَدًا حَسَدِي عَمْرَ بْنَ عُبَيْدٍ عَلَى هَاتَيْنِ الْكَلِمَتَيْنِ. In my life, I never envied anyone for any statement or any quality or attribute other than Khalid bin Safwan, that he could diffuse such a volatile situation with such maturity. For the right things you said, may Allah reward you. For the wrong things, may Allah forgive you. So anyway, he asked me to retort. I said, no, Abu Bakr, I will not retort. فَرَفَضَ الْأَرْضَ وَانْطَلَقَ. He left the date palm and the property and off he went. Again, I get a shiver in my back. I have an argument, I dash to my dad. You have an argument, you go to your ustad. Can you imagine the richness of the environment of Sahaba? They had a dispute, we'll meet at the lap of Nabi alayhi salam. Wow. Let's go there to the court of Nabuwat and there we will resolve it. So he goes to Nabi alayhi salam, وَانْطَلَقْتُ أَتْلُوهُ. And I also tag behind. فَجَاءَ أُنَاسٌ مِّنْ أَسْلَمٍ. So some of my fellow colleagues from the Aslam tribe come and they say, Rahimallahu Aba Bakrin fi ayyi shay'in yasta'di Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa huwa alladhi qala laka ma qal. But so strange, he was at fault, you the victim, and he wants to complain to the Nabi of Allah about you. Listen to the environment. What did Rabia do? Oh my young boy, your father could be wrong. Your mom could be wrong. Your ustad could be wrong. And wrong is wrong and right is right. But don't forget the protocol in which you deal and the sensitivity of the case with which you deal. When you understand, you are treading on your paradise. I'm not saying condone the wrong. No, no. اِعْدِلُوا وَلَوْ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِكُمْ. That's the justice of Islam. Say if you are wrong or your parents are wrong. But watch the sensitivity with which you deal. Listen to this. I wish you appreciated and understood Arabic. Your hearts would burst. You know what did Rabi'ah say? They came and they said, but so strange. Abu Bakr complaining, but he's wrong. You're a victim. He said to them, أَتَدْرُونَ مَنْ هَذَا. You know who you're talking about. You know who's this. هَذَا أَبُو بَكْرٍ هَذَا ثَانِيَ اثْنَيْنِ هَذَا ذُو شَيْبَةِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ إِيَّاكُمْ لَا يَلْتَفِتْ فَيَرَاكُمْ تَنْصُرُونِي عَلَيْهِ فَيَغْضَبْ فَيَأْتِي رَسُولَ اللَّهِ فَيَغْضَبُ لِغَضَبِهِ فَيَغْضَبُ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ لِغَضَبِهِمَا فَيَهْلِكُ رَبِيعًا. Oh my Allah, oh my Allah, oh my Allah. He said, this is Abu Bakr. This is the person whom Allah speaks of two in the cave. صديق أحمد صاحب الغار الذي هو في المغارة والنبي اثنان أعني أبا بكر الذي لم يختلف من شرعنا في فضله رجلان هو شيخ أصحاب النبي وخيرهم وإمامهم حقا بلا بطلان وأبو المطهرة التي تنزيهها قد جاءنا في النور والفرقان. Oh, the poet says it. He said, this is Abu Bakr. This is the oldest Muslim. I'll translate these couplets now. Move from here. Let it not be he turns around and he sees you helping me against him and he becomes angry. Then he comes to the Nabi of Allah and the Nabi of Allah becomes angry because Abu Bakr is angry. Then Allah becomes angry because Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Abu Bakr is angry. Then who will shelter Rabi'a? Today's Muslim, when he abuses and exploits, does he think that Allah's Nabi will become angry and who will give me shelter? When he's doing haram and fraudulent and lying and deceiving and distorting and corrupting and doing everything. What were the words of Rabi'ah? Iyakum, beware. La yaltafit, let him not turn and see that you're helping me. The poet said, Siddiq Ahmad Sahibul Ghar. This was the Siddiq of Nabi alayhi salam. Sahibul Ghar, who was his companion. Huwa fil magharati wal nabi yuthnani. They were only two in the cave that Allah spoke about it. A'ni Aba Bakrin. I'm speaking about Abu Bakr. Alladhi lam yakhtalif min shar'ina fi fadlihi rajulani. From the beginning of this ummah till the end of time, no two opinions are on Abu Bakr being the noblest of this ummah after the galaxy of Anbiya. هو شيخ أصحاب النبي وخيرهم وإمامهم حقا بلا بطلان. He is the noblest, the purest, the most pious of all. وأبو المطهرة التي تنزيهها قد جاءنا في النور والفرقان. And he is the father of that chaste woman who Allah praises in the Quran and in Surah Nur and in other places of the Quran. So they say, ما تأمرنا? What do you advise us? He said, go quick, move. Irji'u. So they return. وَانْتَلَقَ أَبُو بَكْرٍ. And Abu Bakr goes alone. فَتَبِعْتُهُ وَحْدِي. I followed behind alone. حَتَّى أَتَى النَّبِيَّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. This is only the first incident. La ilaha illallah. He comes to Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. And then, look at this words. فَحَدَّثَهُ الْحَدِيثِ كَمَا كَانَ. Oh, I just love these words. Rabi'ah said, I came behind
And I heard Abu Bakr narrate the sequence of events precisely as they occurred, without adulteration or adding or distorting or sensationalizing in it. He said it, if I had to say it, I wouldn't say it any different. Where's our society? Completely too different, like it happened in different eras. So then I sat there, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's head was down, I came behind. He said, Ya Rabi'a, Malaka wali Siddiq. Rabi'a, oh man, what's happening with you and my Abu Bakr? Rabi'a, what's the matter with you and Abu Bakr? I said, O Nabi of Allah, there was a bit of an exchange of some unpleasant words, and then he said to me something which he regretted, and he told me that retort and respond, and I did not say anything. So he said, Ajal, that was good, Abu Bakr or Rabi'a, but you could have told my Abu Bakr, Ghafar Allahu laka ya Abu Bakrin. Abu Bakr, may Allah forgive you. May Allah forgive you. So he said, O Nabi of Allah, I apologize. Ghafar Allahu laka ya Abu Bakr. O Abu Bakr, may Allah forgive you. Fawalla Abu Bakrin wa huwa yabki. Abu Bakr turns and he's tearing away. The environment was a completely different. Qadisiyya, Tabrani makes mention, Ibn Jarir makes mention of the narration. Shaqiq says, Iqtahamna al-Qadisiyya sadra al-Nahar. We fought the battle of Qadisiyya in the morning. Fatarajana wa qad ata as-salah. It was the time of salah and then we return. Usib al-Mu'adhin. The Mu'adhin was injured in the battle. And now it was the time of salah. Fatashaha an-nasu fil adhan. Ay arada kullu minhum an yakuna huwa al-ghalib. Now came the time of salah, the passion of the virtue of adhan. Look at that environment. We came out of the battle. The muadhin was injured. Now it's the time of adhan. We had another fight here. Who's going to give adhan? We had another fight here. Who's going to? Why? Because of the dua of Nabi alayhi salatu wassalam. فَأَقْرَعَ سَعْدٌ بَيْنَهُمْ Sa'd radiallahu anhu then decided to draw lots. فَخَرَجَ سَهْمُ رَجُلٍ One person's name came out and then he called out the adhan. An environment of vying with one another in virtue. دَخَلَ لِسُّنْ عَلَى مَالِكِ ابْنَ الدِّينَارِ A thief comes to Malik ibn Dinar. فَلَمْ يَجِدْ مَا يَأْخُذْ He doesn't find anything tangible material that he can steal. So Malik ibn Dinar says, لَمْ تَجِدْ شَيْئًا مِنَ الدُّنْيَا أَتَرْغَبْ فِي شَيْئٍ مِنَ الْآخِرَةِ Listen, you didn't find anything material. Any thoughts? We can give you something spiritual. Wow. Allah says, regarding the tale, وَهَلْ أَتَاكَ حَدِيثُ مُوسَى And have you heard of the tale of Musa? In Bayan al-Quran, under this ayah in Surah Taha, Hakim al-Umar writes, Al-Istifham lit-tashweeq. The question here is to stimulate. You heard, hey, you better hear. You never heard. You need to know. You say, hey, where you live in, Sheikh? وَهَلْ أَتَاكَ اِذْهَبْ Go to Fir'aun and ask him, فَقُلْ هَلَّكَ إِلَىٰ أَن تَزَكَّى Go ask him, has he got any thoughts of change in his life? So Malik bin Dinar said to him, لَمْ تَجِدْ شَيْئًا مِنَ الدُّنْيَا أَتَرْغَبْ فِي شَيْءٍ مِنَ الْآخِرَ Listen, you came to steal. Sorry, you didn't find anything. But any thoughts on anything spiritual? تَوَضَّعْ وَصَلِّ رَكْعَتَيْنِ Perform wudu and perform 2 units of prayer. So he said, yeah, okay. I mean, can you imagine the passion they had? Right? You negotiate in and you transform in him. So he performed wudu and he offered 2 rakat salah. Thumma jalas. Then he sat down. وَخَرَجَ مَالِكِ إِلَى الْمَسْجِدِ And Malik bin Dinar went for Fajr. So he tagged behind. فَسُئِلَ مَالِكْ مَنْ ذَا So people ask Malik, today you come in with someone next to you. These words are in Arabic. You have to appreciate it. He said, جَاءَ لِيَسْرِقْ فَسَرَقْنَاهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ La ilaha illallah. Ja'a li yasriq fasaraqnahu. Actually, he came to steal, but alhamdulillah, we stole him. Ja'a li yasriq. Hassan ibn Ali changed the environment. Hassan ibn Ali radiallahu anhu. Marran fi ba'di hitan al Medina. He's walking in one of the orchards of Medina. Fara'a abdan ya'kulu luqmatan wa yut'imu al kalba luqma. He's seen a slave sitting, he's eating a mussel and he's feeding a dog. And it was so amazing, it caught his eye. So he went to him, till there was a slice of bread, he cut it in half, he gave the dog half and he ate half. and he's sitting quietly. So Hassan radiallahu anhu, the grandson of Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, we want to boast of our child and say the apple don't fall far from the tree. This was the grandchildren of Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. So Hassan radiallahu anhu says, Lima shatart al-kalb? Why did you cut the slice of bread in half and give half to the dog and half to yourself? He said, Istahat aynaya min aynayhi. Oh man. I knew he was hungry and I was hungry. I couldn't look the dog in his eye and eat the slice myself. I couldn't look the dog in his eye and eat the slice myself. There is a narration in Hilya. I have a thought of it now. Anna Abdullah ibn Umar nazal al-Juhfa. Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu halts at a place called Juhfa. Wa huwa shakkun, a marid. He was sick. He said, Inni la ashtahi hitana. I'm feeling to eat fish. I'm listening to eat fish, you know. And sometimes you list for poultry and sometimes it's beef and sometimes it's seafood. And when you're feeling for one, you detest the other. And unfortunately, this is our nature. فَوَجَدُوا لَهُ فَلَمْ يَجِدُوا إِلَّا حُوتًا. They look around. Finally, they find one fish. فَأَخَذَتْهُ زَوْجَتُهُ صَفِيَّةً. His wife was Safiya رضي الله عنها. She takes it, she roasts it, she cooks it, she prepares it. فَقَرَّبَتْهُ. And she presents it. You know, sometimes you go, you buy a burger, right? And then if it's a mullah burger, I can tell you it's a thin fillet, it's a saucy burger, it's cut in half, and it's all these other specs. And now you sit down in your car and you're about to eat, there's a beggar knocking on the door. But obviously I'm going to restrain my tongue. But you know what flows from there? Nazar. You say the most nasty things. Abdullah ibn Umar is sick. They looked for the fish. It took them long. They finally got it. When they got it, they cooked it. His wife presented it. Cheers! When he was about to eat, a beggar came and knocked. So he said, give this to the beggar. So his wife said, Annaitana. Annaitana. You tired of us. I looked around. Others looked around. وَمَعْنَا زَادْ نُعْطِيهِ نُعْطِيهِ دِرْهَمْ فَهُوَ أَنْفَعْ لَهُ. I got money. I'll give him one dirham. And you'll be happy. وَقْضِ شَهْوَتَكَ أَنْتَ. And fulfill your desire. You know, sometimes just that last bit of drink in that Coke bottle, you know what kurbani that is to part with that? Or the last bite of the chocolate. It's just amazing how we, like, it's not like you didn't have the whole chocolate, but the last part supposedly has a different, the real barakah is there. So you eat what you desire. He said, Shahwati ma urid. My desire is what I want. If you want to make me happy, give this roasted fish to this beggar. Well, can you imagine this environment? So Sayyidina Hassan radiallahu anhu said, why you gave the dog half and you ate half? He said, no, I couldn't look the dog in my eye. He said, okay, billahi alayk. I ask you in the name of Allah. Ghulamu man ant? Whose servant are you? Whose slave are you? He said, Aban bin Uthman. Okay, wal ha'it, and this orchard, it belongs to my master. La barihta hatta a'ud. Don't move from here till I come back. He said, okay. So he went from the Hassan radiallahu anhu. He located the master of this orchard. He said, I seen your slave. I was so impressed. I would like to buy the orchard and the slave. He said, it's a done deal. He bought the orchard and he bought the slave. Faraja'a ila al-ghulam. He then comes to the servant and the slave. He says, Qadishtaraytuk. I've purchased you. So he said, As-sam'u wa ta'atu lillahi wa li rasulihi wa laka ya maulaya. Then compliance to Allah and His Nabi and to you, O my master. He said, Anta hurrun li wajhi Allah. I'm happy to tell you, I bought you to free you. I'm happy to tell you, I bought you to free you. Wal ha'itu hibatum minni ilayk. Wal ha'itu, listen to this. Brothers, make some place for Haji Abdul Baqi. The orchard is a gift from me to you. Picture this, brothers. Picture this here. Imagine you went to, give your car in, and then they gave you a courtesy car, and the courtesy car is smarter. And they say, listen, I don't think we're going to be able to repair your car, but you can keep our wheels. I mean, just for the sake of imagination, because obviously that's not going to happen. But just try to imagine the jubilation that will envelope and grip your heart, the ecstasy, the euphoria, the excitement that will grip your heart. He comes to the slave, he says, I've purchased you. He says, I'm obedient to you. He says, I'm happy to tell you I've liberated you. Thank you. Okay? And the orchard in which you sit in, for the record, I've bought this as well. And as of today, you are the owner of this orchard. The slave stands up and said, قَدْ وَهَبْتُ الْحَائِطْ لِلَّذِي وَهَبْتَنِي لَهُ. Oh my Allah. For the record, I want to tell you that I have also now donated this orchard for the Allah for whom you gave it to me. What an environment when the spoils of the war of Banu al-Mustaliq were being distributed. My time is lapsed, so I'm going to try and wrap up. Unless you guys are ready to eat later. I don't get a yes though. So when the spoils of Banu al-Mustaliq were being distributed, amongst them were the slaves, right? And amongst the slaves was Juwayriya bint al-Harith bin Abi Dhirar. So Allah says in the 29th juz, وَيُطْعِمُونَ الطَّعَامَ عَلَىٰ حُبِّهِ مِسْكِينًا وَيَتِيمًا وَأَسِيرًا إِنَّمَا نُطْعِمُكُمْ لِوَجْهِ اللَّهِ لَا نُرِيدُ مِنْكُمْ جَزَاءً وَلَا شُكُورًا وَيُطْعِمُونَ الطَّعَامَ. And they feed food. عَلَىٰ حُبِّهِ. You must see how much there's a difference of opinion on the dhamir, حُبِّهِيَ. عَلَىٰ حُبِّ الْمَالِ عَلَىٰ حُبِّ اللَّهِ. There's so many different opinions. Despite loving the wealth, for the love of Allah, who they feed? Yatiman. They feed the orphan. Miskinan, the poor. وَأَسِيرًا, and the captive. In Tafsir al-Uthmani, Ghaliban in the Hashya number 10, it's written there that Assyria is captive, which can mean Muslim or non-Muslim captive. And Allama Shabir Ahmad al-Uthmani says, if you make tawassu' in the meaning, if you just extend the Asir, it can comfortably include a person who's indebted. Because he's also Madyun and Maqrood, and he's also Asir, he's a type of a captive. So Allah speaks about these people. So anyway, and then sometimes by virtue of their tongue, and sometimes with their body language, they say, إِنَّمَا نُطْعِمُكُمْ لِوَجْهِ اللَّهِ لَا نُرِيدُ مِنْكُمْ جَزَاءً وَلَا شُكُورًا إِنَّا نَخَافُ مِنْ رَبِّنَا يَوْمًا عَبُوسًا قَمْطَرِيرًا يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ لَوْ عَلِمْتَ بِهَوْلِهِ لَفَرَرْتَ مِنْ أَهْلٍ وَمِنْ أَوْطَانِ يَوْمٌ تَشَقَّقَتِ السَّمَاءُ لِهَوْلِهِ وَتَشِيبُ فِيهِ مَفَارِقُ الْوِلْدَانِ. There's this long poem in which the poet speaks about the severity of the day of Qiyamah. So amongst those that were captured was a woman by the name of Juwayriya bint al-Harith bin Abi Dhirar. And she came in the share of Thabit ibn Qais ibn Shammas, who was Khatibu Rasulillah, the orator of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, just like Hassan bin Thabit was the sha'ir of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Fakatabathu ala nafsiha. I'm ending inshallah. Fakatabathu ala nafsiha. They entered into an agreement of her freedom. So kitabat in Arabic, to simplify, that a slave comes to the master and the master says, earn so much money and you can purchase your freedom. And again, coming back to my same point, create an environment of helping others. Allah speaks about the slave in the Quran that needs to purchase his or her freedom. And Allah impresses upon the general ummah, help them. وَالَّذِينَ يَبْتَغُونَ الْكِتَابَ مِمَّا مَلَكَتْ أَيْمَانُكُمْ فَكَاتِبُوهُمْ إِنْ عَلِمْتُمْ فِيهِمْ خَيْرًا وَآتُوهُمْ مِمَّا لِلَّهِ الَّذِي آتَاكُمْ. My word. وَالَّذِينَ those يَبْتَغُونَ, search, الْكِتَاب, meaning emancipation and freedom, مِمَّا مَلَكَتْ أَيْمَانُكُمْ, from your slaves, فَكَاتِبُوهُمْ, then volunteer. Of course, the amr is nudb, it's preferable, it's not mandatory. إِنْ عَلِمْتُمْ فِيهِمْ خَيْرًا, if you see good in them, in Hidayah it's mentioned, good means they have the ability of earning, offsetting, they won't be a liability. Then Allah says to the general ummah, you know this person wants to earn his freedom, give him money from your money and help him. Give him money. We are a society that works together. So she came into the share of Thabit ibn Qais ibn Sham. وَكَانَتْ إِمْرَأَةً حُلْوَةً مُلَّاحَ لَا يَرَاهَا أَحَدٍ إِلَّا أَخَذَتْ بِنَفْسِهِ. The narration goes, she was a very beautiful woman, she was a very attractive woman. And we quote the narration as it appears. Aisha radiallahu anha says, مَا إِنْ رَأَيْتُهَا عَلَى بَابِ حُجْرَتِي. As soon as I seen her at my door, I became a bit apprehensive. عَرَفْتُ أَنَّ النَّبِيَّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ سَيَرَى مِنْهَا مَا رَأَيْتُ. I feared that she would come to the Nabi of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She is a woman who's desperate, she has beauty. The Nabi of Allah is kind, he's caring, he's soft, he's gentle. So she came to Nabi alayhi salam. She said, Ya Rasulullah, ana bintu Harith bin Dhirar bin Abi ana bintu, I am the daughter of Harith, who is the daughter of Abu Dhirar, and Sayyidu Qawmi, who is the leader of his tribe. وَقَدْ أَصَابَنِي مِنَ الْبَلَاءِ مَا لَمْ يَخْفَ عَلَيْهِ. And you know, O Nabi of Allah, that I am in a crisis, I'm a captive, and I need money. فَجِئْتُكَ أَسْتَعِينُكَ عَلَى كِتَابَتِي. Can you help me and give me some money? The Prophet ﷺ said, أَوَخَيْرٌ مِّن ذَلِكَ. Can I do something better for you? And she said, yes, what is it, O Nabi of Allah? Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, I will buy you off completely. Now look at the beauty. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam didn't say, right, Thabit, you make it maaf. No, no, I will pay for it. I will pay for it. When the masjid was built, Sahal and Suhail, the two orphans, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam insisted. When Abu Bakr came in Hijra, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam insisted in paying. There's a whole write-up why Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam insisted on paying Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu his money and giving the teachings and the values of the Nabi of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, I will liberate you and I will marry you. She agreed. What an honor for her. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam liberated her and married her. Now listen to this. The Sahaba were in battle. They toiled. They strove. They got handsome return. They got booty. They got captives. One captive from the many captives married Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. خرج الخبر أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم تزوج جويرية. News started spreading that Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم married one woman from the tribe. Every Sahabi on his own spiritual instinct released every captive that was in his or her custody, because he said, now it forms part of the in-laws of Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم. وَاسْتَعْظَمُوا أَن يَتَمَلَّكُوا أَصْحَارَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ. They said, I don't want to be keeping in my custody someone who is the in-law of Nabi alayhi salam, and I default in showing the respect. Aisha radiallahu anha said, فَلَقَدْ أُعْتِقَ بِزِوَاجِهِ إِيَّاهَا مِئَةُ أَهْلِ بَيْتٍ مِّن بَنِي الْمُسْطَلِقِ. I have not seen a woman who brought greater barakah to her tribe. I have not seen a woman who brought greater barakah through her tribe than Juwayriya radiallahu anha. Her sheer marriage to Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam transformed everything, and hundreds of people were liberated. I want to conclude with one incident to highlight my message again, and that is, in the love of the seerah of Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, go out and change the environment. Make a mark, my brother, make a mark. There's an incident written in the books that back in the years, there was a man who was of advanced age, and he decided to plant a seed and plant an olive tree. فَمَرَّ مَلِكُ كِسْرَى مَلِكُ الْفَارِسِ أي الْكِسْرَى. So the Persian emperor passed by him and seen that he was planting his seed. He was planting his seed and he was planting an olive tree. So he said to him, أَنْتَ شَيْخٌ هَرِمْ أَنْتَ تَأْمُلْ. You are so old and aged, and you plant in this olive tree. Do you think you will live to see this harvest and this fruit? So he said, أيها الملك غرس من قبلنا فأكلنا ونحن نغرس لكي يأكل من بعدنا. He said, O king, those before us didn't think like us. They planted the seeds and they passed away. And today we harvest their crops and we enjoy it. I'm doing my bit and I'm planting my seed. The generations that will come, they will harvest this crop and they will reap this produce. فَاسْتَحْسَنَ الْمَلِكُ جَوَابَهُ. So the king was blown away by this response. فَأَمَرَ لَهُ بِجَائِزَةٍ. He ordered a royal decree and he said, give this man one handsome gift from the palace. So he was given a handsome gift. So this man was very wise. He said, مَا أَسْرَعَ غَرَسِي. Ma asra, oh, my plantation has produced instant dividends. I barely planted it and I already got fruit out of it. فَاسْتَحْسَنَ الْمَلِكُ جَوَابَهُ. So the king was blown away by it again. And he, فَأَمَرَ لَهُ بِجَائِزَةٍ ثَانِيَةٍ. He said, give him another gift. So when he took the second gift, he said, النَّاسُ يُثْمِرُونَ فِي السَّنَةِ مَرَّةً. وَأَنَا أُثْمِرُ فِي السَّاعَةِ مَرَّتَيْنِ. People harvest their crops once annually. I have two harvests in 1 minute. So the king said, انطلقوا بنا فلو وقفنا على هذا الرجل لم يكفه ما في خزائننا. We need to move on because this man is so smart, my treasures will be depleted. My brother, my message is go out and make the difference. 3 months back, I was invited into rural Kenya. How can I forget that moment? We drove from Mombasa to a place called Malindi. We spent the night there in Malindi with the Al Imdad team. And that night I was given the 200 certificates to kind of sign, and I felt humble about the opportunity where this would be transmitted to people living in shelters, given homes. The next day we drove down to a place called Minjila. The entire nation came out. The backdrop of these two villages that I was invited to inaugurate, each village comprising of 100 homes, taking people out of a straw hut into a shelter home, 1 masjid and 4 wells. Can you imagine? A sister by the name of Hawa. And by the way, Hawa in Arabic, they say, سُمِّيَتْ حَوَى لِأَنَّهَا خُلِقَتْ مِنْ حَيْ. She was created from a living. And this sister passed on due to a terminal condition post the past Ramadan. And there was some medical malpractice that had occurred in her last treatment. So she received some handsome compensation from the medical fraternity. And I say this because her legacy continues. A handsome, humongous compensation was given. The family decided we don't want to use the money and we will invest this to transform the lives of others and isale sawab for our daughter. That humongous whopping 100,000 odd pounds were taken, and an area in East Africa, in rural Africa, was identified. The name of the village was the village of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. I wish I could take you with in my mind and my thoughts. We entered that. Media representation was there. Local parliamentarians were there. They came in their numbers to escort us. Tents were pitched. And then different sermons were given. I was given the opportunity to give the final sermon. The ribbon was cut. And people came out of a hut. We entered some of those huts where 5 people were sleeping the entire night. They have to fold their legs because it's too small to accommodate everyone stretching their leg. I asked the owner, it was 40 degrees, Allah is my witness. I asked the owner of this hut through the interpreter, do you have something to sleep on? So he brought hide in its true form. وَمِنْ أَصْوَافِهَا وَأَوْبَارِهَا وَأَشْعَارِهَا أَثَاثًا وَمَتَاعًا إِلَىٰ حِينَ. From the fur and the skin and the wool, Allah has given you a source of benefit. He said, I sleep on this. I teared. They brought a child 5 years old. His arm was broken. We rush our kids to the hospital. We rush them for anything small. The other day, my 2 sons at 11 o'clock at night were playing, and one stood on the other and he broke his toe. I said, it's time to make tawbah now. Anyway, we rushed to the hospital and immediate intervention. He broke his bone, 5-year-old. No analgesic. No inoculation. They purely put a jabira. For me, it was reviving fiqh. I was reliving the books of fiqh because we speak about it, jabira. So jabara in Arabic means to reform. And that's why one of the attributes of Allah is jabbar. Why is jabbar? Allah mends the broken hearts. Allah mends the broken hearts. The broken bone, jabira. I held the boy. Allah put the dua in my mind. I put my saliva with the soil. Entire tribe came out. Oh my word. The name of the village was Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Tears trickling down my eyes and all the guests that were present. I said, can you imagine the joy my Nabi is getting in his qabr? And can you imagine the sister Hawa, what will be her abode in Akhirah? I'm saying, my brother, stand up, make a difference. Plant your seed, transform the society, and the reward is yours. Allah bless us all.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wassalatu wassalamu ala ashrafil anbiya'i wal mursaleen. سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. اللهم اجعل اجتماعنا هذا اجتماعا مرحوما، وتفرقنا من بعده تفرقا معصوما، ولا تجعل فينا ولا منا ولا معنا شقيا ولا محروما. اللهم حبب إلينا الإيمان وزينه في قلوبنا، وكره إلينا الكفر والفسوق والعصيان. اللهم اجعلنا من الراشدين، اللهم أصلح لنا ديننا الذي هو عصمة أمرنا، وأصلح لنا دنيانا التي فيها معاشنا، وأصلح لنا آخرتنا التي إليها معادنا، واجعل الحياة زيادة لنا في كل خير، واجعل الموت راحة لنا من كل شر. ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين، واجعلنا للمتقين إماما. اللهم إنا نسألك من خير ما سألك منه عبدك ونبيك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، ونعوذ بك من كل شر ما استعاذك منه عبدك ونبيك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. أنت المستعان وعليك البلاغ، ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون، وسلام على المرسلين، والحمد لله رب العالمين.